And welcome, folks, back to the Not Mike and Mike Show. It's been a while since we last saw you. We have a new president, and that's, yeah, I think, a subject for another show.
Yeah, well.
But today, when we last left off with you, we had the Not Mike and Mike, Not Reality League, and we'll get to those results soon. But first, we're going to talk a little bit about the NBA and All-Star Weekend, and have, of course, our first profit segment of 2017.
I'm not very good at that anymore.
But you have a chance to redeem yourself. You know, new year, new psychic senses, so we'll try and make you some money out there. But first, let's talk about the NBA All-Star Weekend. The starters were announced as well as the reserves. So, yeah, get your thoughts on some of the snubs, perhaps, or predictions for the game.
I like both teams in this game. I think there's a lot of really top-heavy guard play coming out of the East. I don't really consider anybody on that team to be a center, unless you consider Antetokounmpo to be a center.
Yeah.
But he's basically the other four. But I like how many centers there were in the West. I think it's going to be a little clash of styles. Steve Kerr is the coach of the West. I forget who's the coach of the East. I think it's Tyronn Lue. I don't know. It's supposed to be whoever has the top record in the East.
Could be Dwayne Casey. The coaching is kind of weird, where you, like, you can't coach back-to-back years. So it's
But, yeah, I think the biggest snub would probably be CP3, and only because they probably didn't get in just because he's hurt. Mm-hmm. But there's stipulations and money that you have to give to people if they do make an All-Star game. So they could have given it to CP3 and then replaced him with whoever they want. They're probably going to have to replace Anthony Davis, too. So I think that he probably should have gotten in, just based on being CP3, and he's only missed 11 games. So on the other side, maybe Carmelo, just because he's, you know, Carmelo, and maybe a sort of a legacy award. Like, yeah, Kobe Bryant made it when he shouldn't have. Why can't Carmelo?
Because he plays for the Knicks, and the Knicks are awful, so they shouldn't be rewarded for anything, honestly. But I think, for the most part, the entire roster's got pretty much spot on. I think my biggest snub would have been, like, a LaMarcus Aldridge or a Rudy Gobert.
I think LaMarcus Aldridge is too boring. Like, yeah, Tim Duncan, at least, was, like, the staple of the league.
And he was the most excellent boring person, yeah,
exactly,
in the world. So, like, when you're boring, it's so superior that it now becomes, like, meta, and it's, like, not – now it's interesting because you're so boring. But Aldridge is kind of boring.
He's just, like, a normal boring guy.
Yeah. And I think Gobert just kind of gets hurt by the fact that there were a lot of reserve centers in Gasol, Marc Gasol, and DeAndre Jordan.
Honestly, I think that there were too many big guys taken in the West. I don't think Marc Gasol deserved it more than Damian Lillard. I think that's a guy you got to talk about, averaging 26 points a game. Gordon Hayward got in with 21 points a game.
Yeah.
So, I mean, obviously stats aren't everything, and you reward winning, and Portland's not very good this year. But I don't know, man. I think DeAndre Jordan maybe shouldn't have gone. Maybe he could have been the replacement for Anthony Davis. Mm. But we'll see. Maybe Damian Lillard still has a chance, because I really don't think Anthony Davis is going to be playing in this game. I don't know. We'll see.
And what do you make of the whole Steph Curry, Harden, Westbrook, it coming down to the fans' vote? Do you have a specific stance that you have on that?
It's always been the fan vote. I'm just glad Zaza Pachulia didn't get voted into the All-Star game.
But Embiid could have.
Embiid could have, and I think next year he probably will, but maybe when you play more than 29 minutes and you don't play either game of a back-to-back, like, play some games and then come talk to me about being on an All-Star team. But I don't know. Like, fans should always it's a game for them. It's an exhibition, so they should have some play in it. Like I mentioned earlier, Kobe's made teams he shouldn't have been a part of because all of China voted for him, and he was just a fan favorite, and it turned out to be great. And we all had a lot of fun watching him block LeBron twice in, you know, 90 seconds or whatever that was. So I don't know. Obviously, when you average a triple-double, you should be an All-Star, and he's probably actually going to be the starter replacement, and you'll have Russell, Steph, Harden as the three, and then Durant
And Kawhi.
And Kawhi. And so Durant's now tipping off.
Against Antetokounmpo, probably.
Sure. Yeah, why not?
And that's just the future of the NBA. Just, you know, 6'11 guys who handle the ball.
It's positionless basketball.
Yeah, it's amazing. Now, speaking of the future, the Rising Stars game is also something that kind of has a new format as of late. They do now the U.S. versus the world instead of the first years versus the second year players. First, before we get to the rosters, what do you think of the whole U.S. world dynamic?
Does
that make that more interesting to you?
I liked rookies versus sophomores because I loved seeing, like, what do you think of when you think of that game? You think of Kyrie Irving putting Brandon Knight on skates and draining him in his face. And, well, not in his face because he was on the ground.
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean.
Above his face.
Exactly. And so, like, the U.S. versus the world, like, kind of has a little bit of cockiness to it. It's like, let's see if we can put it together against the entire planet. And I don't know. It just, like, I get that there's a lot of other countries that have players and you want to showcase that too. But then why do you still limit it to than first and second year players?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, if it's still going to be Rising Stars, make it the Rising Stars. Maybe you have
an age limit or something?
Maybe an age limit, or maybe do it like the Pro Bowl in football. The way they used to do it. They went back this year. But maybe have two captains. Maybe, you know, LeBron is the captain of the East or whatever, and he gets to pick whoever he wants, and it's the first and second year players from the East. And so it's like a mini all-star game.
Think there'd be a playmaker on that team or two?
Maybe not. I was talking to Chelsea's brother, actually. I think that LeBron should trade. The Cavaliers should trade for Brandon Knight of the Phoenix Suns.
Really?
I think that would be a good fit. Phoenix has always been overloaded at guards. Devin Booker is obviously the two guard of the future there. So now Brandon Knight, you're paying him too much to come off the bench. Obviously, this is a conversation for another time. We'll probably get to that a little bit on Monday. But I think if there was a trade to happen, it would be that.
And speaking of Devin Booker, he's going to be one of the main players. I think he has a chance to probably be the MVP of this game, along with Karl Anthony Towns. Let's just run down the list for you real quick. Miles Turner, as well as Malcolm Brogdon from Virginia, one of the rookies.
I love Malcolm Brogdon.
Yeah, he's really a complete player and just makes that kind of that Bucks team a lot more, I don't know, scary, and it just feels like this is more their time that we thought maybe could happen last year with the potential, but having just an all-around player like Brogdon really helps. Marquese Chris, along another son, is out there for the rookie team for the U.S. Brandon Ingram, along with D'Angelo Russell, two Lakers.
Mm-hmm.
Frank Kaminsky, which
He's a second-year player.
He is. And
he counts.
So is Jahlil Okafor and Jonathan Simmons, who with the Spurs has had a nice
He
run.
Got in based off of the first game of the year.
Yeah.
He has done nothing since. We
figured out who Jonathan Simmons was. And now for the world team, they have a lot of size with Joel Embiid, Nikola Jokic, Kristaps Porzingis. I like to see them start all three, honestly.
Yeah,
it's an all-star game. Why not start 3 7-footers, along with Emmanuel Mudiay and Jamal Murray, who turns out is Canadian.
Yeah.
Fun fact of the day, who says you don't learn something every day? Jamal Murray, Canadian, as well as fellow Canadian Trey Lyles with the Jazz, Dante Exum with the Jazz as well. Buddy Hield, who turns out is not from here, from the Bahamas, you know? Little
sure.
island flavor to
Relax.
All-Star Weekend.
Aaron Rodgers would probably love Buddy
here. Domantas Sabonis and Dario Saric round out the rosters for
the
I like
Rising the world
Stars.
In this one.
Yeah.
I'll take the world over the U.S. in this one. Just based off of the two out of the first three, I love Joel Embiid. I take back everything that I ever said about him that was mean. Kristaps Porzingis, double-double, triple-double. I like that size that can still shoot. Obviously, Karl Anthony Towns in the U.S. is going to be a big factor. He's probably actually going to get the MVP if they have that, or whatever it would be called, the rising MVP, potentially the most valuable player come a couple years from now when LeBron retires. It'd be a lot to put on a nameplate, but you can do it. And I don't know. It's probably going to be the world. Wins this one pretty handily. I'd guess like 130, 115, something like that.
Yeah, I just want in the fourth quarter, everybody clear out and just Towns versus Embiid in a three-point shooting contest.
I'm taking it.
Yeah.
I'm taking it every day of the week.
So that will be, that's all we know so far for NBA All-Star Weekend.
Do you think, maybe not this year, but in the future, we could have Barack Obama being the celebrity All-Star game.
That'd be pretty cool.
Because you get Art Duncan or whatever his name is.
The former Secretary of Education.
And so if he can play, why can't Obama? It's probably not that bad of a security risk.
You know, and just him versus Kevin Hart one-on-one.
It'd be hilarious.
It'd be the best ratings for the celebrity game ever.
I'd love it. I'd love it so much.
All right, so we'll start that campaign soon to get Obama into the celebrity game.
Yes, we can. Weekend.
And what's he doing nowadays? He has plenty of free time.
He can only play so many rounds of golf.
Yeah, exactly. But when we come back, we are going to have our first Profit segment of 2017, so don't go anywhere.
Hi, I'm Melanie Fuller with the Solano College Sports Network, here with your Best Buy player of the game, Chance Pippen, and I want to be the next household name for in-game reporting. If you have an interest in a career in sports broadcasting, whether it be behind the scenes or in front of the camera,
then this is the program for you.
Hi, my name is Anthony Williams, and I want to be a sports analyst, video editor, journalist, producer, and graphic designer.
Hi, I'm Tyra Mott. I want to be an actor, but for now, I'm paying my dues behind the camera. For more information,
contact Greg Poff. That's me at solano.edu.
Hey guys, my name is Tiana Wilson, and I hope to be the next TV talk show host or work behind the scenes as a producer. Remember, be the change you want to see. It starts with you. On behalf of myself, Greg Poff, and the students of COM 75 A and B and COM 80 A and B, we thank you for supporting the Solano College Sports Network, your number one source for local sports. And remember,
it's more than just basketball.
It's more than just baseball.
It's more than just sports. It's an education.
Welcome back, folks, to the Not Mike and Mike Show. We are here with the prophet himself, Mike McLeod. And Mike, your prediction skills, are they intact right now?
I mean, it's going to have to be because, you know, I had a couple weeks off to regain my composure. I've been 11 out of the last 12, out of the last 15, I should say, NBA games I've gotten correctly. So I'm feeling good about myself.
Yeah, we've done NFL, we've done NBA, but one thing we haven't done is the world of professional wrestling. And I don't know if you know this, folks, but every single pay-per-view that professional wrestling has these betting odds that people bet on. And one of the most exciting pay-per-views is the Royal Rumble this Sunday. And we're going to go down the match card and the Royal Rumble itself and talk about some of the unique prop bets that are associated with that particular pay-per-view. But without further ado, let's give it to the prophet Mike McLeod.
So we have a lot of different matches. Obviously, the 30-man over-the-top rope battle royal. That's going to be kind of its own mini segment because there's so much to talk about there. But let's just go down the card a little bit. There's two matches in the pre-show kickoff, which airs on like YouTube 30 minutes beforehand, and that is Sasha Banks versus Nia Jax. I think that one's going to be another squash match, which is kind of weird because Sasha Banks has been in the championship hunt for so long. I think Nia Jax, this is her chance to showcase that she's not just good against jobbers and really stake her claim as not necessarily just Charlotte Flair's sidekick and actually a diva. Or not, they don't call him diva anymore, I'm sorry. The women's revolution happened. But then you also have the club versus Cesaro and Sheamus for the WWE tag team titles. That's a lot of fun. I love how weird and quirky this team of Cesaro and Sheamus has been. I think they just keep rolling a little bit, and they're going to keep the titles.
And a weird and quirky stipulation to that match. They're going to have two referees because it always seems that somebody's trying to get this underhanded advantage in their matches. So you don't see, I don't think I've ever heard of a two referee match. So it's kind of a unique spin on your typical.
It probably isn't going to mean much other than maybe he goes, I saw what you did, and like try to kick him out, or maybe somebody wins by disqualification. I don't know. But
I think it could be one of those weird things where like Cesaro's pinning one member, like Carl Anderson.
Oh, and so
Luke
it's a
Gallows
double.
It's a double.
You know, I didn't even think of that, but yeah. that's probably its own odds of that happening. That's probably the exact outcome that's actually going to happen. But either way, I think the titles are going to remain in Cesaro and Sheamus's hands through that match. And then we just continue on forward. We have a six-woman tag team match between Naomi, Nikki Bella, and
Becky Lynch.
Becky Lynch, yeah, thank you. Yeah, I can't read your handwriting
most
of the time.
Yeah.
Why don't you go through the list,
sure,
and I'll just tell you.
Since
what I
can barely read my own handwriting, like 80% of the time, and that team of Nikki Bella, Naomi, and Becky Lynch will be facing Natalya, the returning Mickie James, and the women's champion Alexa Bliss for SmackDown. So who do you have, the heels or the faces?
I'm going to take the heels in this one. I think you can't have Mickie James,
yeah,
the Mickie James, come back and then lose. And, you know, the rivalry is just kind of beginning with her and Becky Lynch. Mm-hmm. So I think that you have to have the champion retain. If you're not going to have her put the title on the line, then you have to have her look good. It just makes more sense for the heels to win this match through some underhanded tactic, some ghost tag that put somebody else legal and whatever.
The one thing that I could maybe say is that this could be the start of a Nikki Bella Alexa Bliss kind of rivalry leading up to WrestleMania.
Yeah, but like, what's Naomi doing there?
You know, she has like glow stuff. Like she like glows in the dark. Like her entrance is pretty cool. You
yeah,
know?
No, yeah. Like, but like, there's no reason for her to be there.
But and she's glowing when she goes to the ring, so that's a reason.
So she's not gonna win.
No.
Just. If it was somebody else, like if Bayley didn't have a championship match and it was Bayley on that team,
yeah,
maybe you have a chance at winning that match. But she is on Raw,
yeah,
so that doesn't make sense anyway. So, yeah, heels win this one.
Yeah. Next, we have the Cruiserweight Championship exclusive to Raw champion Rich Swann. Talking about heels, Neville with a heel switch.
Neville.
Yeah. So who do you have, Neville or the champ?
Just side note, I love Neville's entrance now because he has that like weird red light underglow and it makes his eyes look red like he's demonic. I think it's so cool. I think it works perfectly.
I feel like we could do that with some of our set lights here. Which, by the way, folks,
yeah,
new set. Like,
that
nice
looks
digs,
nice.
Right?
We have a fern now.
Yeah.
A USC helmet is signed by somebody. But anyway.
Rich Swann.
Rich Swann's nobody. Nobody cares about Rich Swann. He looks cool. I gotta admire his physique. But I think that he'll probably win that match, Rich Swann, but it will be through some weird Brian Kendrick sort of maneuver, even though I'm sure they're pushing Neville to be the champion. And it is completely possible. I don't really want to pick a
it's
winner
like a
in this
pick
one.
Yeah.
Yeah. But Neville will either win clean or lose dirty,
mm-hmm,
but not because of anything Rich Swann did.
Yeah, I think the only reason I think Rich Swann could take it is that they don't want to do the whole musical champions thing. This is the third champion they're on in like 4 or 5 months. TJ Perkins won the initial championship with the Cruiserweight Classic, and then Kendrick won, and then Swann beat Kendrick. And so it just devalues
but
the championship
it
you
felt,
just keep rotating.
It felt like Rich Swann kind of lucked into that one. Like he was just kind of an opportunist.
It was honestly a ratings thing because they launched their own Cruiserweight show, 205 Live. And I think they just wanted like some buzz around
Austin
it.
Aries maybe coming in.
Austin Aries, the greatest man who ever lived, on commentary.
Yeah.
And he's going to be a great addition to the Cruiserweight division.
I honestly can't wait. I think that once Neville wins the championship, Austin Aries. I love feuds that are more than just stereotypical like heel face relationships,
mm-hmm,
where you can have two heels but what like one's just like a different kind of heel.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, it's so
like
good.
Austin Aries is the cocky heel, and then the Neville would be like the I'm not valued, you're disrespecting me kind of
exactly
heel. And that would play well together. And I'm calling it right now, WrestleMania, they always had that big ladder match where they just throw everybody in.
Mm-hmm.
Throw their cruiserweights in there. Put seven great cruiserweights in
make
a ladder
make
match.
Make it like an X Division?
Yeah, it would just be
God.
Spot fest after spot fest, and it would be crazy. People would get hurt. It'll be great.
Like Jeff Hardy going through a ladder.
Yeah, exactly. The last, we talked about the SmackDown Women's Champion in a six-person tag match. The Raw Championship is up for grabs with Charlotte, the champion, against Bayley.
And you want to talk about musical championship. Sasha Banks and Charlotte Flair have gone back and forth every time they face each other. Mm-hmm. It seems like they drop the title to each other. To where Charlotte's been on the main roster for what? Less than a year? Mm-hmm. 8 months maybe? And she's already a 4 or 5-time women's champion. It's ridiculous. But that being said, she is undefeated at a pay-per-view. I don't see any reason to stop that now. She does have the lineage being Ric Flair's daughter. It just, you know, Bayley, it just feels like they got tired of the Sasha Banks mm-hmm. rivalry, and so they just threw her in for Flair, no pun intended. But I don't see Bayley having really the momentum to carry this one. Mm-hmm. It wouldn't make sense logically, even kayfabe. Mm-hmm. But I'm just going to take Charlotte this one to retain.
Okay. So the other matches are for the WWE and WWE Universal Championships, the two main championships in WWE. Let's start with SmackDown. AJ Styles, John Cena looking to tie Ric Flair for most heavyweight championships in a career at 16. Do you think he does it on Sunday night?
No. I don't think Cena does it on Sunday night. Maybe this is for my own selfish gains. If he does, he's going to drop it at Elimination Chamber just because I think AJ headlining WrestleMania is what everybody wants, including the company and creative. So it's weird how they've booked this with John Cena being the face that runs the place, but he's almost acting like a heel. Mm-hmm. And he's saying that basically he got the championship match because of who he is and he didn't have to work for it. And it goes against everything that John Cena has been. Whereas,
like, where's the hustle in just
exactly?
Showing out,
yeah. Well, it is a hustle. Yeah. and AJ, although he has done some heel things in the past or leading up to this, he's considered the underdog, even though he has the title. And so it's weird. Like I said, I love weird face heel dynamics. Mm-hmm. I think AJ is just he's too popular, he's too hot. AJ Styles is one of the greatest wrestlers on the planet, and I think he retains this one.
And so now let's go over to the Raw side of things, where they have a kind of a wacky match for their title, where Chris Jericho is the partner for Kevin Owens, their little staple going on. Kevin Owens, the champ, faces Roman Reigns, but Chris Jericho is going to be suspended above the ring in a shark cage. Where else do you see that in the world of sports or sports entertainment, but only in the WWE? A man is locked in a shark cage above the people fighting in the ring. That's crazy.
Like a sexy pinata.
Like a sexy pinata, folks. So who do you have? Do you have Kevin Owens or Roman Reigns?
Oh, my God. I really don't want to even watch this match. even though it's going to be fun and Roman Reigns is going to have a couple of great spots, I think they should lead off the card with this one. Just because it allows whatever fallout may be to happen for the entire duration of the Rumble mm-hmm. leading up to the 30-man Royale. Because I think there's going to be some fallout from this. And I wouldn't be surprised if Roman Reigns wins. But he's also kind of the Rumble big dog. And so I wouldn't be surprised if he drops this one only to come back and be like a 40-minute entrant in the Rumble. Mm-hmm. I think that you had talked about while we were talking about this, mm-hmm. Chris Jericho came on Jonathan Coachman's show, said that he was going to drop brass knuckles to him. I think that could backfire. I think that'd be a lot of fun to see a Superman punch with brass knuckles. Mm-hmm. I think everybody knows, if creative is as straightforward as we think they are, which they aren't, that it's going to be KO versus Chris Jericho at WrestleMania. Mm-hmm. For either the United States title or the Universal title. And I've been talking a lot and I haven't really made any predictions. I'm gonna say Roman Reigns wins this one. He might drop it at Fastlane to somebody. I think it needs a better rivalry than Roman Reigns versus like Braun Strowman. I don't think there's enough time to really get into that rivalry. Yeah. I guess they could. But
they're talking about it, and yeah. I think that would just bore a lot of people, including myself. But
and you're a mark.
Yeah. So. I'm so easily to get like interested in things, and that bores me. So let's run down your picks so far. You have Nia Jax and Cesaro and Sheamus in the pre-show. Mm-hmm. You have the heel team of Natalya, Mickie James, and Alexa Bliss for the SmackDown six-woman tag match. You have Rich Swann retaining, right, over Neville?
Yes.
Yes, Rich Swann.
Well, that one was kind of weird.
Yeah, he kind of was forced to pick one just because he is the prophet. He has to make a prediction.
If you're going to parlay any of them, don't parlay that one.
Also retaining will be Charlotte and AJ Styles in their respective championship matches and new champion in Roman Reigns.
It's weird. I only picked one championship switching hands.
Yeah.
Maybe I'm a fan of continuity leading up to WrestleMania.
WWE, continuity, two things that don't always go hand in hand. And you talked about how the Rumble can be its own segment. I think we're running a little bit long, so we're going to make it a third segment.
Yeah,
so
sure.
When we come back, folks, Prophet here will predict the Royal Rumble match, so don't go anywhere.
Ever have an interest of being on camera as a sports broadcaster? Or have you ever wanted to learn how to operate a camera or what goes on behind the scenes?
If you want to be a star behind the camera,
or you could be the captain of everything behind the scenes, then we have just the program for you.
Well, did you know that Solano College is the only community college in the nation that has a sports broadcasting program and television network, which can give you a certificate to get an entry-level job in sports broadcasting?
Classes will be held right along the library in room 121.
For more information, contact Greg Poff. That's me. At Solano.edu. And remember, it's more than just sports. It's an education.
Welcome back, folks. Money Mike here, trying to make you some more money, predicting the 30-man Royal Rumble match in the pay-per-view this coming Sunday for WWE. Now, Mike, as I alluded to earlier in the show, there are a lot of interesting prop bets regarding the Royal Rumble because it's such an expansive match that a lot of things can happen within it. So let's first talk about some of the side bets going on before you predict the winner.
Sure.
All right, let's talk about the longest person, the longest time spent in the match. Rey Mysterio has a record overall with over an hour in the Royal Rumble match itself. I don't think anybody has that kind of stamina this year. Who do you think will last the longest this year?
I'm going to go with Sami Zayn. He books himself really well in sort of this really underdog, sympathetic, you feel bad for him. He's a good Irishman. And his facial expressions are just really good at getting reactions and pops from the crowd. And so I think, you know, maybe just a guy that comes in, maybe not the first entrant, because I think that'd be putting a little bit too much spotlight on it, but maybe three or four, and he just spends maybe 45, 50 minutes in the match, just kind of biding his time, a lot of time spent under the turnbuckle, and, you know, one of those many ways that small people continue to be in the match. You know, you just feel like Sami Zayn needs a push at some point. And so if he can make the claim, kind of like Axelmania, he said he wasn't ever eliminated and he's the longest entrant and all that. I think that was super funny.
Yeah.
And that got super over. I think that Sami Zayn saying that he lasted the longest, and if he had just been, you know, it was the luck of the draw, bad luck of the Irish. I don't know, however they want to do it. But Sami Zayn, longest time.
Okay, so now it's kind of surprising because there's such big names and big people. Big Show, Braun Strowman, Goldberg, Brock Lesnar. And you think one of the smallest guys is going to last the longest.
Big guys never last the longest. Yeah. And like even the years when like Kane and Undertaker, remember that year that Kane and Undertaker just stood in the ring and everybody else was gone and they just waited for the next guy to come down and it was Scotty Too Hotty. they never last the longest, right?
Because the gets the worm with Scotty Too Hotty. No.
Okay. Yeah. Anyway.
That wasn't a great one. So.
It's over there now.
Okay.
I don't know. There's a lot of big people, but big people notoriously don't last that long.
Yeah.
They don't have the stamina.
But what they do very well is eliminate people. So
yes.
Who do you think will have the most eliminations this time around?
I think it's a foregone conclusion. It's the only one that has negative odds on a money line for most eliminations. Braun Strowman is a 1-3 odds to have the most eliminations. You just feel like that's what they're building toward. He's been unstoppable in everything he's been in. Every match is a squash match, basically. You just feel like he's going to have one of those Roman Reigns, Keynesian sort of entries where he comes in, clears out the ring because there's 15 people in the ring now, and now he brings it down to like 6. And then maybe Sami Zayn eliminates him? That would be my dream. But probably not going to happen.
Yeah. And speaking of Sami Zayn, last year at the Royal Rumble, he was one of the two surprise entrances for the WWE, along with AJ Styles, the current WWE champion. So this time around, it's always guaranteed a surprise entrance or two are going to happen. Yeah. Who do you feel like will surprise the crowd and make their debut in the Royal Rumble?
Re-debut? Yeah. I mean, if you believe the media, then Kurt Angle will not be in this match. But I would just love so much if Kurt Angle was in this match. If you can find him at good odds, maybe take a flyer on him. I think Samoa Joe would be a good entrant. He's kind of run roughshod over the entire NXT locker room. And
he's not even booked for the pay-per-view. It's not a pay-per-view. It's their event, the takeover event. Usually he's in some sort of match, not even in a match advertised. So it's pretty safe to say could be
in like we mentioned Austin Aries. He's in 205 Live. Obviously, AJ Styles. You just feel like he's the next guy from TNA. And then Bobby Roode, obviously, later on. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't even be surprised if Bobby Roode was in it. But also, another guy that's not Samoa Joe, the Samoan Submission Machine. I think that's the coolest nickname in the world. Finn Balor, he has been nursing a shoulder injury. He's not supposed to be back yet, but we've seen John Cena come back from worse injuries. Torn pectoral in 4 months to come back and be the final entrant. And I wouldn't be surprised if Finn Balor is like entry number 30, just so he gets a huge pop. Maybe he only lasts like 2.5 minutes and he gets thrown out and he's not one of the last 4 or whatever. But I think to have him come back, he's so weird and so cool.
What I would love to see is them set up maybe a Taker Balor kind of a feud for WrestleMania, because Taker always wants to deliver, and with the Demon Balor as his alter ego to have that supernatural kind of storyline.
Yeah,
I think that's a fit that a lot of wrestling fans want to see.
I mean, if Undertaker's not going to win it, that's maybe a direction they could go. He currently has the 4th best odds to win the match, The Undertaker. So maybe.
Yeah. And we talk about who's going to eliminate who. Now, we kind of have the feeling that Brock Lesnar and Goldberg, they're going to decide each other's fates. Which way do you see it going? Goldberg eliminating Lesnar or vice versa?
Well, Lesnar was basically the jobber in their last match. And I think that you had said that Goldberg's booked for
Fastlane.
For Fastlane. So maybe nothing happens here. I think that'd be a wasted opportunity. I think Lesnar's going to eliminate Goldberg. I think that, you know, Lesnar still has to be the guy. Otherwise, that Goldberg match means nothing and it invalidates everything he's done up until this point. So Lesnar eliminating Goldberg kind of makes a 1-1. And then they could meet at Fastlane. Maybe nothing's conclusive there. They fight at WrestleMania. Goldberg goes on his way, has a great rest of his life.
Yeah. And so we also kind of talked about maybe a potential Wyatt family breaking up of Randy Orton and Bray Wyatt. Do you see that culminating at the Royal Rumble? We've seen some dissension as of late on SmackDown.
Well, we actually talked about this during the break. I think it'd be super funny to have Randy Orton come out, RKO like 7 people, eliminate.
Out of nowhere somehow.
Yeah, I don't know how you keep doing it out of nowhere. He's in the middle of the ring.
Yeah.
It's not out of nowhere. But then like Bray Wyatt like comes to him and is like, "No, you need to get out. This is my Rumble." And Randy Orton just leaves. But I think that's the wrong booking. He currently has the best odds, Randy Orton, of winning the Royal Rumble. And I feel like that's so random, right? It just doesn't feel like that's the correct booking. Maybe you luck into Bray Wyatt winning an Elimination Chamber match, and so now they have to fight, and so the entire lead up you think Randy Orton is just going to lay down and than he doesn't at WrestleMania. I don't know. It just feels like that'd be super forced. And I feel like that's a bad bet. Maybe something happens between them and they have their own match at WrestleMania 2. I just don't think it's going to be for a title.
Do you know what the worst bet would be, though? Taking Mojo Rawley to win the whole thing. That's fair. How is Mojo Rawley in first of all, SmackDown's entire Battle Royal that they had on Tuesday was filled with tag teams of, like, the Ascension and Breezango. And I wanted Tyler Breeze to win, honestly, because he is getting buried for no reason, just because Vince McMahon doesn't like him, and Prince Pretty, I don't know why you wouldn't like a guy named Prince Pretty, you know? But Mojo Rawley, the only reason why I think he is even in the WWE is for the small chance that Rob Gronkowski, one of his good friends from college, I think they played together at Arizona State, that he might come to WWE because his good friend is in there, and that would be a huge draw to get Gronk.
Speaking of celebrities, I think a surprise entrant in the Royal Rumble could be Ronda Rousey. That's my bold prediction.
Wow. Mine would be Shaq, because there's rumblings of Shaq and the Big Show.
Royal rumblings?
Royal rumblings of the big Aristotle versus the Slim Show. Because he's not very big anymore at WrestleMania, so he could make a surprise appearance, you know. But with all those surprise appearances, all the favorites, who do you have winning?
I actually mentioned him earlier, surprise entrant Samoa Joe. I feel like Samoa Joe and AJ Styles, that's kind of why I chose AJ to win the match and retain, is just because I feel like there's too much chemistry and too much electricity to not have Samoa Joe and AJ Styles meet at WrestleMania. That would be the pinnacle of both of their careers. And, you know, it just makes too much sense not to do. And so Samoa Joe wins the Royal Rumble, challenges the SmackDown champion at WrestleMania, and that leaves whatever you want to do for Raw's Universal Championship. You can go any number of ways.
You can have Braun Strowman win. You can have one of your part-timers.
Exactly.
Brock or Goldberg.
Maybe Undertaker wins again. Who cares?
Who knows? Well, there you have it, folks. Mike is predicting Samoa Joe to win the 2017 Royal Rumble. And looks like we're out of time. We didn't get to announce the winner of our Not Reality League, but, you know, stay tuned to our next episode to find out. That's it for us here at the Solano College Sports Network Studios. Thanks for watching. Thank you.